As you're looking there, if you have a Bible that's similar to mine, there's these lines around this passage, and there's these little notes that are right there. I think I've put them on the screen here. This is the word about these text notes here. So the one in the Pew Bible here and in my Bible here says, "The earliest and most reliable manuscripts and other ancient witnesses do not have John 7:53 through 8:11. Maybe your Bible says the earliest manuscripts and many other ancient witnesses. Oh boy, my screen's not working right here. Sorry about that. Do not have John 7:53 or 8:11. A few manuscripts include these verses wholly or in part after some other places." So there's different text notes that you might have in your Bible here. I just want to say a quick word about that. This story was probably not in the original Gospel of John. I think that's pretty fair to say. Pretty much everybody agrees on that. This story here was probably not in the original Gospel of John. If you look at where it is here, it's kind of a little awkwardly placed. It's not in the earliest and best manuscripts that we have right here. However, this is a true story of Jesus still, and that's why we still have it. So what probably happened, what I imagine happening, is that this was a story of people who knew Jesus. One of his disciples was with him when this happened, or a number of them were, and so they experienced this, and they carried it with them, and it circulated, and people thought it was important, but it wasn't part of the Gospels. But because it was a real story of Jesus, they put it in here. So that's at least the way that I imagine it happening. This is a real story of Jesus. It probably just wasn't in this spot in the fourth gospel, in the original manuscript that it had. But it's still worth looking at. It's still in our Bibles, and it's still a real story about Jesus, and we have a lot to learn from it. So just wanted to say a word about that. Let's read it. "Then each went to his own home, but Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. At dawn he appeared again in the temple courts, where all the people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, 'Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now, what do you say?' They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. But Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, 'If any one of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw a stone at her.' Again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left, with the woman still standing there. Jesus straightened up and asked her, 'Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?' 'No one, sir,' she said. 'Then neither do I condemn you,' Jesus declared. 'Go now and leave your life of sin.'" It says that Jesus again appeared in the temple courts and he sat down to teach them. Back then, rabbis would often sit to teach. So you would sit down, if you were a rabbi, like so, something like this, and you would have people gather there, and others, your students, would sit at your feet. And so there's a couple times in the Bible where it says they sat at Jesus' feet. And so Jesus would be sitting in the temple, and he would be teaching everybody like this, and there would probably be other people sitting right around him. Okay, and the temple court, this is a busy place. There's a lot of other people around. And as a teacher, teachers usually give out tests and exams and assignments. But this time, the teacher is going to get the test. Jesus, as a teacher, is going to be tested by the people who really don't like him and are looking for a basis to accuse him and get him into trouble. So, in verse 4, they even call him teacher, probably in a derogatory sort of a way. But they have something here. They got him now. At least they think so. They got him. They got a perfect setup for him, and they are going to test him. They have this woman who's caught in the act of adultery, which brings up a question. How do religious leaders catch someone in the act of adultery? And the way it's worded there, it says they caught this woman in the act. Okay? Now, in order to do this, in the law of Moses, it says everything must be established on the testimony of two or three witnesses. So that means to catch her, there had to be two of them, at least. Two or three. So we'll just say two. There had to be two witnesses. And according to the interpretation of the law that was pretty well codified by that time, it had to be unmistakable. So it wasn't like this woman was just alone with a guy. No, it was unmistakable what was going on. There was no question. So, two witnesses, unmistakable circumstances here. How does that happen? The only way that something like this happens is if it was set up. So it's pretty easy to imagine that there was a husband here who knew that his wife was cheating on him. And so he told the authorities, and they, instead of, you know, stopping that or calling her on it or, you know, asking her to, you know, why are you doing this? Or just without any concern for her, they just wait for it to happen and then catch her in the act. So they set up this woman. And then, of course, it takes two to commit adultery, doesn't it? Where's the guy? I mean, why don't they have two people there? They should, right? Well, obviously, they let him go for some reason. And her, she was an easy target. So they let the guy go and they just drag her along. It's really obvious here in this scenario that these Pharisees and teachers of the law, they hate this woman. They can care less about her. She is just a pawn in their game against Jesus. She is just a piece on a board for them. That's all that she is. And they're actually bringing her to him and proposing that she be stoned. So this woman could die. They don't really care about her at all. It says in verse 3 that, well, actually, how did they word it here? The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group. They literally brought her and then just made her stand, it says, in their midst. So right in the middle of everyone. We're getting as much attention as possible here. Attention is part of their game. They want a lot of witnesses to what is about to happen because they're looking for a basis to get Jesus in trouble. So they need lots of witnesses. They stood her in their midst. In our sinful human nature, we tend to use people as props, don't we? For our own ends. God doesn't look at people that way, but we have a tendency to do that. We want things a certain way. We want people to be in their certain spots for our own objectives. This is what the Pharisees are doing here. It's obvious that they don't care about her. It's also obvious that they don't really care about the law at all. They're acting like they care about the law. You know, in the law, Moses commands us to stone such women. So they're acting like they care about the law, but really they don't. They don't care about the law. Because the law actually specifically commands that both the man and the woman be punished. It's pretty specific about that. I think I put it on the screen here. Leviticus 20, verse 10 says, if a man commits adultery with another man's wife, the wife of his neighbor, both the adulterer and the adulteress must be put to death. Both of them. So it's pretty specific here as what the punishment should be. And yet, the way they word it here, the law commands us to stone such women. So they're not even interpreting the law very well here. It's the way they word that. They don't care about the law. But they have Jesus right where they want him. They have a perfect setup here. Everything was going according to plan. And it's kind of obvious that this was all planned and staged just nicely so that they could get Jesus right where they want him. Their setup against Jesus was ideal here, okay? So Jesus has two options. He only has two ways that he can respond here, at least in their minds. He has two options. He can either A, uphold the law of Moses and get arrested by Rome. That's option one. So he could say, yes, let's stone her, and then Rome will be like, nuh-uh. No, you can't do that. Capital punishment was the most jealously guarded government power that Rome had. And so they would take that and not let anybody have the power of capital punishment, because that was a signal of who was really in charge. If you could execute somebody, then that meant that you were in charge, that you held the authority. Rome didn't want anybody else to have that. Now, once in a while, it would still happen. But when it did, people would get in big trouble for that. Just a few years after this happened, after Jesus here, there was a high priest who ordered that people be stoned, and that guy was arrested and deposed from his position for that. Because Rome doesn't want anybody else carrying out any executions, because that's their job. That means they're in charge. They get to say who lives and dies. That's their power. So if Jesus says, yeah, let's do what the law says and let's stone her, now he's in trouble with Rome. Okay? So that's option A. The other option is that he could set aside the law of Moses, but then discredit himself. He's supposed to be a teacher. He's supposed to be one of the, you know, in their minds anyways, a teacher of the law. So if this teacher of the law is throwing out the law and just saying, we don't have to do that, then he's discrediting himself. And when you're in the temple area, you have all of these people who are ready to follow the law here. And all of the right people here, he's got two options and he can't really do either one of them. And they got all the right people who are watching right now. So first of all, they're in the temple and it's right after a feast time. So it's busy, it's packed. You know, just like churches are packed on Christmas and Easter, this is festival time, lots of people are there, okay? All the right people are watching. So at the temple, there were mobs of people who were zealous for the law. Okay, mobs of people. Now, a mob of people, they're capable of anything. If you have a large group of people, lots of things can happen there. There's a reason why it doesn't take one person to riot. Mobs riot. Because when you're in a large group of people, there's anonymity. Because if the whole group is doing it, then individuals aren't held responsible. So there's even cases where there's a whole group of people who witness a murder and nobody intervenes at all. Because it's a group. Nobody wants to get in trouble or step in harm's way. So mobs will do anything. And being in the temple here, right at feast time, we have an opportunity where this woman really could be stoned. Because there's a mob. And who knows what's going to happen. Okay? So stoning is a real possibility here. Jesus could really get in trouble. But because it was also festival time, Roman soldiers were patrolling the temple grounds. During festivals, the king, particularly King Herod, actually is recorded as saying and ordering Roman soldiers to patrol the temple grounds to make sure that nothing gets out of hand. So, we have Roman eyes watching here. And these Roman eyes are ready to pounce if anything gets out of hand. So we got quite a pressure cooker situation here. All the elements are in play just right. This is an ideal setup to trap Jesus. Who cares about this woman or anything else? But we are going to get Jesus, right? This is an ideal setup. So how does Jesus respond? He doesn't answer. He starts writing on the ground. He starts writing in the dust that's on the ground there. It's fascinating to see how many different things people guess of what he was writing. We don't really have any official clues to what he wrote there, but there's all these fascinating guesses out there. There's some who are say that he was simply doodling. This was apparently a Semitic custom where if you're frustrated and you're passing the time, you just kind of doodle. So that's one guess. Another guess is that he wrote the first line of the 10th commandment, "You shall not covet your neighbor's wife." In other words, to all of these people who are trying to get him in trouble, hey, you guys are all guilty of adultery too, aren't you? And breaking the law. So that's another good guess. Another one is that Roman judges would write out their decision before they announced it. And so maybe that's what he was doing. He was about to write out a judgment, and that's what he was doing. If the adultery was framed, like it sounds like it was, another possibility is that he wrote Exodus 23, verse 1, "You shall not support a wicked man as a malicious witness." So if there's this husband who's trying to set up his wife to get stoned, and these people are supporting this guy, Jesus could have written Exodus 23, verse 1, "You shall not support a wicked man as a malicious witness." But the one that stands out to me as the best possibility, Jesus writing on the ground, may have been in light of Jeremiah 17, verse 13, which says this, "O Lord, the hope of Israel, all who forsake you will be put to shame. Those who turn away from you will be written in the dust, because they have forsaken the Lord, the spring of living water." Just a little bit before here, Jesus announces himself as the living water. They are trying to trap him here, and he is writing now in the dust. It's kind of a challenge to them. Now, we don't know that that's what he wrote, but that makes a lot of sense to me. It says they persist in questioning him, because they're not going to let him get away. So he's starting to write down in the dust here. You know, he bends down. He's, you know, writing things maybe. And And they're up here with this woman. Okay, come on. You got to give us an answer here. What are we supposed to do with her? Are we going to follow the law? Or what are we going to do? Huh? Come on. You know, because they're not going to let him get away. They got him right where they want him. And they're not going to let him just sneak out of this. So they might think he's trying to avoid the question. He's just writing in the ground. Well, we're not going to let him get away with that. And then Jesus responds. In verse 7. Literally, he says here, the sinless one of you first throw a stone at her. The sinless one of you first throw a stone. This is loaded with meaning. The first thing that this does is that Jesus here diffuses the mob by turning attention to the individuals. See, groups operate on anonymity. So people will do things that they otherwise would never do because they're not going to get caught because they're surrounded by other people. But now what he's doing here is he's turning attention to each one. So he's almost like pointing at each person here. The sinless one among you first throw a stone. Who's it going to be? So by taking the focus off of the group, he's putting the focus on each individual person. Who's going to go first? This diffuses the mob mentality. Nobody's going to want to be the one to step forward and be first to do something like that. Not under these conditions. So he diffuses the mob. Another thing that he does here, he affirms God's law, but he shows that it's impossible to fulfill. He's affirming the law. He said he doesn't say don't throw a stone. He's saying go ahead, throw it. But he also says, none of you can do it, can you? Are any of you without sin? No. Are you? You know that. How can you throw a stone? Somebody should be throwing a stone at you too. So he affirms God's law. The law is there. It's valid. It's real. It's still in effect. But we can't do it. In fact, even these highly pious, righteous teachers of the law and Pharisees, they can't even do it. It's impossible to fulfill. In fact, it was pretty common knowledge, even back then, that all of us were sinners and none of us measured up. So, who wants to be the first one to act like they are sinless? Nobody's going to do that. Jesus validates the law but removes its penalty. So he says, yeah, the law is there. It's in force. It's real. It's valid. It's still in effect. But he takes the penalty away. So this woman, even though she is guilty of a law that is still real and valid, she's not going to get stoned for it. He removes its penalty. This woman is not for stoning. He in effect says. This is exactly what the cross is for us. The law is still valid. We still have an Old Testament. We didn't cut it out once Jesus arrived. It's still there. It's still in effect. But the penalty is removed. Even though we cannot fulfill the law, God's requirements of us, the penalty is removed. Jesus paid that penalty. That's what the cross is. He is paying the penalty for us failing to follow the law. So the law is still valid, but Jesus takes the penalty away. And ironically, the sinless one among them was the one speaking. Jesus was the sinless one of them. He could have thrown that stone. Easy. It's an old movie. It's called The Greatest Story Ever Told, but I like the way, there's one way that they depict this scene. And Jesus, they say, you know, the law calls for her to be stoned, and he says, yeah, it does. He picks up a stone and he says, if any one of you is without sin, cast the first stone, and he holds it out. And he kind of goes around the crowd. Anybody? And they all just kind of back away. And he keeps holding it out. And then he kind of looks at this woman. And then he kind of does this, like he might throw the stone. And he does this. Throws it down. He could have thrown that stone. Because he was the sinless one. But he doesn't. He threw it down. So for us, just a thought for us here, we can identify sin in our lives and even in one another's lives, and we can draw boundaries to contain it. In fact, we should. But we cannot punish it. So a verse that gets thrown out of context a lot is, judge not lest you be judged. People will use that to try to say, hey, you can't tell me I'm sinning. Well, we can identify sin in ourselves. We can identify it in other people. This is what we're supposed to do as a body of Christ. We're supposed to call each other on our bad stuff. How else are we going to improve? We're usually blind to our own sin. But we cannot punish it. So if your spouse was beating you, you would want to draw some boundaries on that, of course. You'd want to say, I'm going to be going somewhere else where I'm safe now. If your friend was stealing from you, you would be drawing boundaries and say, no, I'm not going to put up with that. Not cool. If you had somebody who is telling lies about you or telling secrets, you're not going to be telling those secrets to that friend anymore. You're going to be drawing a boundary and saying, apparently I can't trust you, so I'm not going to be telling you things that I don't want spread around anymore. So we draw boundaries. That's appropriate. If your pastor starts preaching things that are false and not true, you got to draw boundaries around that. But we can't punish sin. We cannot take the penalties of the law and force that on people, like the stoning part, because Jesus has removed that penalty from us. He's already done that. He's already taken that punishment. And so we need to identify sin in ourselves and in one another, and we need to draw boundaries around it to contain it, to stop it, because this is bad stuff. But we cannot punish it. We can't punish it because Jesus took away that penalty. Government, they can judge, they can be juries, and they can punish things like murder and theft. But as individuals, no, we cannot do that. This is a lesson for us here. So Jesus, after he says this, the sinless one of you first throw a stone at her, then he goes back and starts writing on the ground again. He's not going to watch his opponents be humiliated because he has the perfect comeback and he is now shaming them. This is an honor-shame culture. If you are shamed, that is like the worst thing. Shame is worse than death. You would rather die with honor than live with dishonor. Okay? So, Jesus just shames his fierce opponents, and he's not going to watch. He's going to bend down. He's going to write in the dirt, perhaps to even try to get them to think about Jeremiah 17 and to maybe turn and change their ways. He's not going to watch them be humiliated. He's not going to rub it in. But Jesus has now humiliated them on their own turf, and now he's in trouble. This woman would have died, maybe should have died, and now he is the one who's in trouble. He takes their hostility to her and then he turns it on himself. The penalty, the anger, the vengeance that they had against her is now on him. Because of doing this, he will die and she won't. Jesus is marked for death now more than ever because of this. He just humiliated them on their own turf. This is the temple grounds. This is their territory. Here we have a great picture of what Jesus did for us. We are the ones who sinned. And Jesus is the one who's going to die. He takes the penalty that was ours. He took this woman's penalty. And he is in trouble now, and she is not, even though he is the sinless one. So this story is a great picture of the cross. I'm glad that they didn't just let this story fade into the background. This is part of our scripture, because this is a perfect story of what Jesus has done for each one of us, not just this woman. This is our story too. And this, the words that he speaks to this woman, he speaks to all believers. Did you hear it when he was saying that? I'll read it one more time. "Then neither do I condemn you," Jesus declared. "Go now and leave your life of sin." That's to us. Look at the screen here, and let's answer this question together. In the Apostles' Creed, we talk about the forgiveness of sins. What do you believe concerning the forgiveness of sins? I believe that God, because of Christ's atonement, will never hold against me any of my sins, nor my sinful nature, which I need to struggle against all my life. Rather, in his grace, God grants me the righteousness of Christ to free me forever from judgment. We have the forgiveness of our sins, just like this woman had the forgiveness of her sins. So Jesus says, "Neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life of sin." In other words, the judgment is real. The punishment, it's severe. But we are forgiven, and our forgiveness comes from the judge himself. In Romans 8, it says, "Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is now interceding for us." And then it goes on to say, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ?" Who? What? Wouldn't you love to know how this woman responded? Like, if she said something or if she did turn her life around, wouldn't you like to know that? We don't know what happened. And I think there's a reason why. We don't know how this woman responds because that's not the point. The point is, how are you going to respond? If Jesus says this to you, how are you going to take that? How are you going to respond? How is tomorrow going to change for you? If he says this to you, or is it going to change at all? Jesus declares, "Neither do I condemn you." I don't condemn you. But he doesn't stop there. He says, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and leave your life of sin. Leave it. Because the law is real. I've just removed your penalty. Don't continue in it. You are not condemned, but don't do it anymore." And so, forgiveness on God's part means repentance on our part. We can't continue in this. The law is still real. He's taken our penalty away. In Romans 2:4, this is your Bible reading for today, God's kindness leads you toward repentance. God has been kind to each one of us. Jesus has said this to every one of us. Are we going to walk around burdened by guilt? No. Are we going to go around continuing in sin? No. Let's bow our heads and let's pray.